Let us pray. Oh, Father in heaven, on this Father's Day, we stop first to recognize you as the Father of life, the universe, and everything. We thank you, Lord, that we have the privilege, the honor, the inspiration to come into this place and worship you. Help us to show you the honor you don't require, but that absolutely life does require. It's in the name of the triune God of grace that we pray. Amen. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I welcome you here to his worship today. Happy Father's Day to all you fathers and grandfathers and maybe expectant fathers. Well, I guess your wife would be expecting. No, I guess you would be expecting too. There is a special time of fellowship and relationship following the worship today in Pearson Hall. We hope that you will join us. Followers of Wednesday evenings with Pastor Pat, we're going to wrap up 1 Peter this Wednesday evening. We'll be wrapping up, and then we will be going on hiatus. We will be returning sometime to be determined later after I return from my clergy leave in the fall. It may be late fall, or that might even be January. So just kind of keep posted that we're finishing up 1 Peter this week and taking some time off. We are looking for, as we head toward the fall, Sunday worship nursery volunteers. So if you are interested, we need you to reach out to the office. We're going to have like two levels of volunteers. There will be the primary group of people, and then there will be those who will assist them along the way. But it's the primary people who will be scheduled, and then we will work with others as well. So if you are interested, please let the office know. Let's see, what else? I am still continuing to cast a net for those people who wish to consider being part of this church family. We're going to try to get that accomplished through the month of July and August. So if you are interested, please contact the office with your contact information because it requires me to be able to try to create a meeting, a schedule of the three meetings so that I can get you all there. So we kind of work around people's vacations, people's schedules, things like that. So please let us know. Next Sunday, remember, we have our inaugural Youth Olympics next Sunday, and all kids are welcome up to eighth grade. We even have an option if in case the weather turns inclement next Sunday, which is still a week out, we will pull it inside Pearson Hall, and then we will move fellowship and all that stuff down the hall to the community room. So just wanted to let you know that that is coming up next Sunday as well. Last but certainly not least, we've been very fortunate. Years ago, there was an educational scholarship, an endowment that was put together, and every single year we take in applications from kids who are active in the ministry of the church here. And we try to give them a little something to help with their college journey. So, but it also was a program that was also designed for kids who were going and pursuing, or adults who were pursuing an educational opportunity to go into active ministry. So that's what the program is today. I'm going to bring up our scholarship recipients for this coming school year, 2022-2023. First is not here today. She's on vacation, but Jessica Berghofer. And so Jessica is one of those applicants, and she goes to Dickinson College out in Pennsylvania. Next, I'm going to call up, although she's still sitting in place, Leah Dykstra. Come on down. Chris and Tom, you can start coming down too, by the way. But Leah is at West Virginia University School of Pharmacy. Okay, so she is in a six-year program where at the end she will have a doctorate in pharmacy and she'll be out there prescribing medications. Not prescribing, filling prescriptions. Christopher Sherry, Rochester, what is it? Institute of Technology. I should know this by now. He's studying to be an engineer. And you're what, the sophomore year coming up, right? Third year. Oh my gosh. I'm getting old. Congratulations. Okay, let's see if I have it right this time. Tom Sherry, Rochester Institute of Technology. He is an engineering major going into his third year. And last but certainly not least, standing behind me is our now official second year seminary student at the University of Dubuque Theological Seminary, and that is Melanie Williams. Then God said, "Let us make man in our own image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and of every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female. He created them.
I woke up with a broken heart in my chest. I couldn't sleep, couldn't get no rest. Weighed down by the heaviness of life. And I tried to shake it, flipping through my phone. But all it does is make me feel more alone. How could anything that feels so wrong be right? 7 billion voices separate us. But only one can show us who we are. We are made in the image of, made in the image of God. Beautiful shades of love. We are made in the image of, made in the image of God. That's where the light comes from. We all need the same medicine. We all need another second chance. There's no first in line at the foot of the cross. Father, forgive me. Show my concrete heart. We are made in the image of, made in the image of God. Beautiful shades of love. We are made in the image of, made in the image of God. That's where the light comes from. We fall apart, we all lose sight of heaven, but still your love is chasing us. And oh, give me a heart for heart that's breaking. Give me eyes to see. We're so much more than flesh and blood. We are made in the image of, made in the image of God. Beautiful shades of love. We are made in the image of, made in the image of God. That's where the light comes from. Made in the image of, made in the image. of God. That's where the light comes from.
Patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the love. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the love. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. Know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. And we'll guide each man's dignity and save each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Oh, Lord Jesus, great reconciler of the universe. You reconciled all sin, cleansing it and pulling it away so that we can be reconciled with the throne of heaven. You bridged the gap and you created a faith for all nations, not just a single nation. And yet out of that single nation, you did come forth, and the whole world has been touched. When we look at the globe, we find that there are Christians on every single continent in the world. And yet there's still so much work to do, Lord. So help us, O Lord, to walk through life, even though we ourselves are broken humanity, that we struggle, we are anxious and we fear. Help us, Lord, and strengthen us. Open our eyes and our hearts. Help us to see others as we see ourselves. Help us to hear the voices of others in harmony and unity with us and our voices. Help us to hear the voices of peoples long silenced. O God of reconciliation, we joyfully come before you today, the healer of the entire universe. Lord, hear us now as we join our voices and our hearts together as we pray the words you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, we pause to recognize our lives' contributions into the ministry of Jesus Christ. Those contributions come in many ways. It starts in the heart. It moves outward into our physicality, and it includes all that we are, because all that we are is His. So we offer up our lives and we offer up the produce of our lives to continue this ministry as a vital ministry for Jesus Christ.
We are the same. We are beautiful when we come together. We are be the same. So tell me why we're divided. Woke up today, another headline, another innocent life is taken in the name of hatred. So hot today, and if we think that it's all good, then we're mistaken, 'cause my heart is breaking. How you laugh, how you cry, pointing fingers, taking sides. When are we gonna realize we all be the same? We more beautiful when we come together. We all be the same. So tell me why we divided. If we gonna fight, let's fight for each other. If we gonna shout, let love be the crime. We all need the same. So tell me why we're divided.
Who are we to judge someone by the kind of clothes they're wearing or the color of their skin?
Are you black? Are you white? And we are the same inside. Father, open our eyes to see we all be the same. We more beautiful when we come together. We all be the same. So tell me why.
Made for more.
your face. You will forgive our sins and you will heal our incredible land. In the name of the Holy Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our Lord and our God, we offer up this very offering to you. We offer up our lives, Lord. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for caring for us. Help us to bring your good news and your love to the world. It's in the name of the triune God of grace that we pray. Amen. All right. Where are you? Maddie, I don't even know why you left it from up here. Now you're running back. You got the box. Thank you, sir. I know, I see him. I see him. There's more. Yes, they are. They're still coming down the stairs. Wow. I'm telling you, they just keep coming from north and south and east and west to all come sit on the carpet with Pastor Pat. Hey, that doesn't look like one of yours. Oh, I know who it is. And the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Hi. I know it's a little cramped up here because the bells are here, but that's okay. Let's try this again, though. Hi. Hey, look, Andrew's here. All right. Let us see what this is. All right, so it's a pirate ship.
Yeah.
And if I, you built it where?
We built it out of wood.
Out of wood, but like, did you go like to Home Depot or did you do it in the basement or? You went to Lowe's, it's one of the, okay, there you go. So it came in many pieces, but now it is one. But you used a hammer. Yeah, there are nails in this, okay. But you know, catch this. It's got a plank. It's got a plank. It's got a retractable plank. Okay. You know what planks were used for? It was like the timeout for pirates. Okay, but it was a timeout that you didn't come back from. Okay, because the bad dude, the one who misbehaved, they had to go to the end of the plank. If they were lucky, they tied a rope to their foot and then made them jump off, and then they'd be dragged behind the ship. And if they were to survive, which wasn't likely, because you know who follows ships? I'll give you a theme song. Dun-dun, dun-dun, dun-dun. Sharks follow ships. But other times, there was no rope, and it was a one-way trip where they went off and into the water. Well, guess what? All right? 2,000 years ago, because of all the things that every human being on the planet or ever will live on the planet is broken and does bad things. We all sin, one way, shape, or form. Everybody sins. One person walked the plank for us. One. He was both God and man. Planks are made out of wood, and so are crosses. But he was no bad guy at all. In fact, he took our place, and yet he didn't do anything bad. What a great gift. Let's pray. Lord, we are all pirates. We are all flawed. We are all broken. Thank you, Lord, for walking the plank for us. And it's in the name of Jesus and in his love that we pray. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. I like that. That was good. That was a good one. Let's see. I need a young lady. Are you going to be here next week? You can make it happen. Watch it, watch it. I don't want it to fall and knock at somebody's head. Get out of here before we wound somebody. Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of Mark. This is probably in the top five of my favorite stories in all of the Gospels. And from there, Jesus rose and went away to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And he entered a house that he did not want anyone to know, yet he could not be hidden. But immediately a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit heard of him and came and fell down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile, a Syrophoenician by birth, and she begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. And he said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." But she answered, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." And he said to her, "For this statement you may go your way. The demon has left your daughter." And she went home and found the child lying in bed, and the demon was gone. And now we turn to the Lord's brother James in his letter. "Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he looks like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing." So let me set the scene for you from a standpoint of Jesus that day in that house with that woman laying at his feet, okay? You need to understand that the Hebrew people who had been on this long journey for thousands of years, everywhere they went, they seemed to be hated. Everywhere they went, they seemed to be feared. Over and over and over again, the scenario is the same. Here comes the Hebrews. Let's persecute them. So within the Hebrews' culture, what develops with them is also that same type of hatred. Yes, they are not to intermingle and because of the fear of foreign gods. and sacrifices and those types of things that went on with people like the Canaanite people. However, they were always told through the Abrahamic tradition that all nations on the earth will be blessed through them. And yet they continued to foster a hostility to the point where it became systemic. Anybody who wasn't a Jew was considered a dog. Gentiles were considered dogs. Why? Because dogs in the first century Jerusalem were not cute little shih tzus like the one I walk up and down on Main Street several times a day. They are animals that eat from the gutters. And in the gutters are the clippings and the throwings and the leavings from dinner, but also bathroom pots, other things. Dogs are filthy animals. And the Jews developed this understanding of the others as filthy animals. Jesus, on the other hand, calls attention to this. A lot of times what ends up happening, and it happened to me in seminary, where there would be people in class who would interpret that particular story as if it was a women's rights thing, okay, where Jesus was wrong and that woman told him off. No, the context is quite opposite. She has thrown herself at her feet because she knows she doesn't belong in the house because she's a Gentile. Yes, to boot, she's a woman. But she is willing to do anything to save her child. Jesus uses that as a teaching moment. Not necessarily for her. Why? Because there's 12 knuckleheads standing behind him. They don't get a lot of things. And he takes a moment where he shows them that their thinking and their culture's thinking about how to treat these people has to change. Why? Because it's going to be on the backs of these people that Christianity is going to spread. Not Jews, although there are Jewish Christians. The primary source of new Christians in the first century were Greek and Roman and Libyan. They were from all the four corners of the earth, and they weren't Jews. Because the message of Abraham, the promise of Abraham, was now going to spread out through the world. And in order to do that, you had to break down the system of the culture in which the 12 apostles had been raised in. And Jesus challenges that. It's not right to give the children's food to the dogs. First, you feed the children, then maybe the dogs. She says, even the dogs will eat the scraps from the table. And Jesus says, for that you have said well. For that you have done well. That lesson stuck. If you believe, as I do, that the Gospel of Mark is probably from Peter's perspective, that message stuck. That woman, one of those others, one of those dogs, was just as worthy to receive the gospel of Jesus Christ as anybody else. A powerful reversal of fortune because you have both Gentile and Jew who discriminate against one another and are going at it with one another, and they have to be put together in order for that gospel to do what it's going to do, heal the world. Today I bring you a movie from 1947. 1947. What was happening in the world in 1947? What had just happened to the world? In 1947, it's approximately 6 to 8 months after the Nuremberg trials have ended. The atrocities that have been brought forth, the atrocities of what's been brought forth against not just the Jews, but communists, gypsies, homosexuals, clergy, people who disagreed with the Third Reich, the things that they did. Movies, film footage of the liberation of concentration camps, people who looked like walking skeletons, but more importantly, bodies stacked up like cordwood. The absolute, utter symbol of our time of systemic hatred, systemic bigotry. Gut-wrenching and real. Gut-wrenching and real. Now I bring you Gentleman's Agreement. Gregory Peck plays a man by the name of Skyler Green. He comes in from the West Coast. He's a writer for magazines. He's been called in from the West Coast to New York City. The lead editor of the magazine wants him to do an expose on systemic anti-Semitism, systemic bigotry aimed at Jews in New York City. It's an extraordinary movie, and think about this, this is 1947. And what ends up happening is he goes undercover, Skyler does. His last name is Green, so it's real easy to hear the word Green and also hear endings like Berg, Men. He goes undercover, even though he's not Jewish, he goes undercover as a Jew to see what is there, to not just rehash the same old articles, yes, it's there, he goes to live it. God's calling. He goes out into the world to live it as a Jew, to experience it. Three primary Jewish characters that he comes across in the midst of this. The first is one of the board members at the magazine. He is an elderly Jewish man, wealthy. And when he finds out that they're going to do this expose, he looks at the editor and he looks at Skyler and says, why would you drag that up again? Why would you continue to pull that up? That's just going to create problems. Why continue to stir the pot? Think about that. That's coming from a Jew. Second character is Skyler's new assistant in the office. They start talking, and she doesn't know that he's not Jewish. So she shares her secret. She's Jewish too. But she changed her last name. She cut off the ending because she had applied to the magazine three other times with a Jewish name and was turned down for a job. But when she cut off the end of her name, she got the job. She had to compromise who she was in order to get a job. Oh, you should have seen the conversation with the editor of the magazine, with the HR guy after that one. Wow. The third one is Skyler's good friend, who's just returned from the European theater where he fought for the United States Army. He's still in uniform. It's that fresh. He's in New York City to interview for a job. His wife and his kids are out on the West Coast, and this would mean a move to the East Coast, but he's got to find a big enough house for them. So he's offered the job, and he says, let me see if I can find housing. He can't find housing. But he doesn't quite understand why, but he does. He understands why he can't move into certain neighborhoods, because there seems to be gentlemen's agreements only in those neighborhoods. Now, it's interesting how the overt stuff is real easy to spot. We know the overt stuff. We've all grown up with the overt stuff. We've seen it. We've watched it start to go away. Not completely, but mostly. We've seen a lot of the overt stuff. It is the subtle ones. It's the ones that hide in plain sight that are there and they still plague us. They're still there. And that's what the movie portrays. Skyler goes to a hotel. He's not allowed to stay in that hotel. They won't necessarily tell him why. It's just all of a sudden his reservation is canceled. He can't get a room. Very, very subtle. No explanation, because after all, people in polite society don't talk about such things. He runs into it at a restaurant. He goes to a garden party up in Darien, Connecticut with his girlfriend at her sister's house. And there's some weird stuff going on there. Subtle. Really, really subtle. But it's there. And it's present. And the more he experiences it, the more angry he gets. The weight of the world is coming down upon Skyler. His own son. Now, Skyler's a widower. His own son, who knows that they're not Jewish, but he asks his father, what does that mean? So he's playing along. And just because of his father's reputation, the kid starts getting bullied and beat up at school. One thing after another, after another, after another of things that happen. But the real interesting blow comes when Skyler has an argument with his girlfriend. His girlfriend, who is a nice Christian girl, who's actually quite progressive in her mindset, and yet what comes up is the fact that she seems to be enamored with the fact that she's dating a guy with a Jewish reputation, and yet she knows he's not Jewish. They have a confrontation, they break up. Jump to a scene where now his friend, the Jewish friend, is sitting in a restaurant with her as she's trying to process why Skyler broke up with her. And they get to talking, and she says, well, I'm not racist. I'm not bigoted. I'm not anti-Semitic. I'm not this. I'm not that. You know, in fact, one of her friends at one point even says, I'm not anti-Semitic. I have Jewish friends. We've never heard that before, have we? But she tells Dave the story about she's there at some sort of mixer, and there's a gentleman who's actually telling bigoted jokes. She goes, well, I walked away. And David looks at her and says, and what did you do next? Ooh. Ooh. To walk away is one thing. To be able to look at somebody and say, you know, do you realize what you're saying? Do you realize the joke that you're saying? It's a fascinating movie. If you haven't seen it, go see it. Go get the video. I'm telling you. The library has it. It can be found out there. It's a fantastic movie that really challenges us. And it jumps from 1947. It'll jump you all the way to our time to help us understand the subtleties that are there. Well, Pastor Pat, we've gotten over all of that. That's all is well. It's just a bunch of people who are complaining. Let's talk about that, since we live in Sparta. In the 1920s, a river was dammed in order to create a lake. The lake filled up. It was going to be vacation land. They decided to call the lake Lake Mohawk. That's all real fine and good. That works. Okay, except for the Mohawk people lived in northern New York and across into Quebec and those type of places. The local indigenous people were the Lenape, or Lenape, it all depends on how you pronounce it. To advertise their little lake community for vacation homes, they went out and they hired themselves an Indian chief and his young wife, Chief Big Mountain. Princess Little Dove, I think her name was. White Dove. Thank you. They're buried right out here, by the way. They went out and they hired themselves, indigenous people, to advertise a lake community that looks like an alpine village around a lake. And yet, they weren't even allowed to live on the lake. Oh, not just them, by the way. Dare I say it? Anybody here with an Italian last name or Italian heritage? You weren't allowed to live around the lake. Anybody here with skin darker than, let's say, white? You weren't allowed to live on the lake. Unfortunately, Eric Cohen is not here today, but Eric grew up Jewish. He wouldn't have been allowed to live around the lake. There was a gentleman's agreement that you couldn't live around Lake Mohawk unless you were basically white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. My father grew up with this. My father grew up in Newark, and on hot summer weekends, his parents would take them out of Newark to get them to a place that was cooler and nicer and had some places to swim and an amusement park, so they would go up to Lake Hopatcong because they knew they couldn't come to Lake Mohawk. My father grew up knowing this. Gentlemen's agreement that you cannot live around Lake Mohawk if you're not the right sort of person. Systemic. Well, Pastor, that doesn't happen anymore. That's not really out there anymore. We don't do that anymore. Several years ago, we had a construction project on our roof. It had been damaged in the winter. The roof was doing this. The walls were doing this. We had to get a permit to fix the whole thing. One of our elders, property council chair, goes down to a meeting to make sure that our thing gets approved and all that type of stuff. And on that night was also an approval for a brand new store to take over the old Stop and Shop building. You know where I'm going with this. So John came back and he said, we got approved. And then he says, hey, have you ever heard of Ocean State Job Lots? I'm like, yeah, that's the coolest place in the world. As they started to hire, as they started to put their sign up, as the word started to get out that Ocean State Job Lots was coming into Sparta, I heard not just at the auditorium before one of my daughter's concerts, not just on the street, but in these very halls. A place like that shouldn't be put here. It should be over in Newton with those people. Can somebody show me where in the town's charter it says that? Those people. Every time we say those people, it doesn't have to be race. It could be religion. Those people. After 9/11, do you know how many Sikhs in this country were beat up and harassed because of 9/11? Oh, by the way, Sikhs are not Muslim. And yet they were treated as such. It's there, folks. It's there. And it's not just white people. It's across the board, just like Jew and Gentile. It's all flavors. We can carry hate and sin like the best of them. One of my favorite singers of all time is Louis Prima. Louis Prima was of Sicilian descent. Let's hear it for the Sicilians over there, Deb. Okay, Sicilian descent. Comes up to New York City to play in a club, and then he's let go before he can play. Why? Because the owner thinks he's one of those people. He thinks because of the color of Louis Prima's skin, he is a very, very dark-skinned Sicilian man, was. Now, he can't play here. Too much pigment in his skin. Think about that. It's still here. Just a few years ago, Josh Gottheimer, local congressman, was running again for his spot. And there was a Jewish family up in the Newton area who had Josh Gottheimer signs. Okay, everybody can put signs in their yards. Okay, no problem. Except for the fact that not once but twice somebody sprayed swastikas on that family's garage door. But it doesn't exist, does it? I got off social media back during the Barack Obama and Mitt Romney election because of the stuff in the way that those two men were depicted by other human beings that people, so-called Christians, were circulating on Facebook. Every time you saw Mitt Romney, it was sort of a weird combination of dunce cap and Mormonism. Every time you saw Barack Obama, he was depicted basically and sometimes literally as a monkey. But it doesn't. That doesn't happen. Do you ever realize what a toxic soup, a toxic wasteland that social media is? I got off. I had had enough. Because that's just like cancer. That's just like injecting poison into yourselves. Well, but it's just social media, and you could always turn them off. You can always turn them off. Guess what? Remember the old adage that, you know, a few snowflakes are pretty? Come up with 10 million snowflakes, and you could watch a tractor trailer go off the highway? Let me show you how many snowflakes on social media put a kid in a grocery store hunting black people in Buffalo a few weeks back. Tell me it doesn't exist. It's in the system. It's in the ethos because we are sinful, broken people, and it's got to stop one person at a time. I'm not asking you to go out on the street and protest. I'm not asking you to go stand up every Sunday or Saturday for 4 or 5 hours by the post office. I'm not asking you to do that. What I'm asking you to do is that, what's the adage when they talk about the train station and the airports and stuff? If you see something, say something. Don't walk away like Skylar's girlfriend. Say to that person, I don't appreciate the joke you just told. Because you've just stereotyped. We can go down the list. Remember the days when there was Polish jokes and Irish jokes and Jewish jokes and Italian jokes? Black jokes, Asian jokes, remember all that? Think about it, my friends. It starts with us one way, one person at a time, one group at a time, to change the philosophy of stuff that just has worked its way into the system. Oh, and by the way, it's not the government's perpetuating the system, it's human beings, broken human beings that are perpetuating the system. But it starts with us. It starts with us hearing a scripture from Genesis that says, all humanity, male and female, have been made in the image of God. Start that way. Real simple. Everybody you meet is made in the image of God. I can live with that. That's pretty simple. Second, Paul, Corinthians chapter 13. Love is anything but all that list of nasty stuff. Love is enduring. Love is powerful. Love is essential. So, love those who are made in the image of God. What was the old children's Sunday school song? Red and yellow, black and white? There was something about that, wasn't there? Or last but most importantly, listen to James's words as he had learned from his brother. As they had all learned from Jesus, James said, don't just be hearers of the word, be doers of the word. And if the word says you're to love, then act upon it. If the word says you're to stand for the orphan and the widow and the oppressed and the sojourner, oh, that sojourner one, that's an interesting one. Stand for something, folks. Stand together for something. Again, this is not a political message. This isn't a right-wing, left-wing message. This is a people message. This is a Jesus message. This is a Christian message. And that's as close as you're going to get to an apology from me on this particular sermon. Because I'm telling you, all you have to do is open your eyes and look out there, open your ears and listen, and you will see and find things that have been hiding in plain sight all along. Yes, we've made progress, but we still have a long, long, long way to go. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Don't forget to join us over for fellowship. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. You need to understand that all week I was haunted to bring you a message. A message I felt compelled to give. Just thank God I didn't give you all the list of examples from our modern time within our community in which drives this membership council would have had a cow because they want you all for food. But as you're sitting there eating today, as you're walking from this place, I want you to look around. I want you to look around. It's beautiful. Young, old, male, female, white, black, tan, Asian, African, North American, South American, Far East. We even have somebody from England. We just let them hang with us. My friends, love is patient and kind. Be patient with me. Be kind alongside me as we do this together in a world that is so divided right now. And of course, we do it together. And we do it with him. For Christ goes before you and Christ is behind you. Christ is to the right of you. Christ is to the left of you. Christ is above you. Christ is below you. Christ is within you. Christ is in the face of everybody you meet. Christ is in the eyes of everybody who sees you. Christ is in the hearts of every one of you. Show that heart to them so that they can see Christ. I bless you in the name of the triune God of grace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia. Amen.
God of the impossible, God of the impossible, God of the impossible, you are who you are. God of the impossible, God of the impossible, God of the impossible, you are.
Happy Father's Day. Go in peace.